Una y dos. Y dos. Una y dos. Una y dos.
Hello and welcome to Cortesnyc NYC Livestream, the podcast.
This show broadcasts out of New York City.
We are your hosts, Cortesnyc NYC
and Carla de Puerto Rico.
And on this show, we talk about art, creativity, city life from a Latino perspective. I'm a visual artist.
And I'm a singer.
And this is episode 92, The Art of the Quarantine, Part 1.
This is a mega episode. Due to the coronavirus, we have to stay in, we have to stay home. So we call 5 of our past guests to check on them.
So shout out to Deedouble Design, Dr.Greedy, Twrexx Monsta, Mr.Arc, and Audible Lecter in that order. And you guys are going to be hearing their stories, our conversations with them. Everybody, all our listeners out there around the world, stay safe, stay indoors, keep your distance, and listen.
Stay healthy, drink a lot of vitamins, stay hydrated, because that's the best way to fight the virus. But most importantly, stay home.
And listen in. Let's get started, Carla.
Let's go.
Got our man Mr. Deedouble in the house.
I'm back at it.
What?
Here from reporting live from Corona Nation, otherwise known as New York City.
Oh, yeah. Oh my God.
Yeah, we're late to the game, but we're catching up quickly, huh?
Word for real. Like, of course it's gonna happen here. I mean, look at people. We're on top of each other.
Yeah.
The trains. It's gotta. Of course it's gonna happen here.
Yeah, man. Yeah, I mean, they were saying that the amount of congestion and between just New York and New Jersey alone, the fact that people might be traveling back and forth, it's hard to even quantify the numbers correctly because they can't track it. That's why they're trying
There's
to
no
have
way
people
to
sit
track
still.
It.
They want to have. That's why they want to have people sit still. Just sit down for a minute. You know?
Yeah.
Let us count.
Sit down. Just chill out. But there's no way they could track it because. They're not even fully sure how this thing spreads. They're like, oh, it's on the table. It could be on materials, on tables, on cloth. Then it could be in the air for like 3 hours. They don't know anything. So it's like, how do you even track that?
Yeah, that's the scary part.
Yeah.
Definitely. Right,
so because we're not scientists, we make art, we don't make science.
We should make science. Let's switch. What do you gotta do to make science?
I just gotta
go to school.
Exactly. I'm like in the middle of all this. I'm like the last thing I'm thinking about is sitting down on a computer and making designs. It's very difficult if we don't settle everybody down and get them quarantined. It's not gonna make much sense.
No, it's not.
Yeah,
maybe some quarantine art could come of this.
Quarantine.
Empty streets.
I'll tell you one thing, you know, actually one positive thing about this, and I think, I'm sure you've probably seen the memes all around, but like, you know, artists, we are used to working in isolation and working remotely.
Exactly.
So like, that aspect of it, it's probably easy for us.
Yeah.
I think it's...
Not like, only that, we're also like used to being in our own heads, you know what I mean? Like, everything's going on. We can spend time alone, you know what I mean? Like, there's other people who, like, you know, see all these people need to go outside and need to go to bars and shit. Like, we don't have to do that. Like, we spend a lot of times in our brains, our imagination. So, you know, we got a leg up there and we're used to just being alone doing what you gotta do.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's true.
A bunch of dorks.
You know what I think we fail at though, as us designers being quarantined, is we don't think about obvious things like soap, toilet paper.
No, food. Not at all.
Q-tips.
Too abstract thinking, I would have never thought when this whole thing started, I would have never thought the first thing everybody's gonna go grab is fucking toilet paper.
Yo,
it's not even a thing that makes you shit yourself. So it makes no sense, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's like, what? Toilet paper?
That didn't catch up to me until, like, I also was like, oh, that's ridiculous. Until I started thinking about it and doing the math, and I'm like, well, if we are stuck in here for a couple of weeks and and we got no, it's not like we're in the office. We don't have anybody refilling this, you know, restocking the bathroom. I'm like, oh, yeah, that's on us. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we're restock. I mean, you thought of it after.
Yeah, we're like, we got 3 rolls left.
But I'm classy. I use wipes, all right? I don't use fucking toilet paper.
But you also have a shower at home, so I also don't get
butter.
You want to go old school on it, huh? Showers
yeah, I mean, if you run out of it and you're saving paper, like.
How did it affect you personally?
I mean, personally, work-wise, you know, that's again, fine, yeah. we're artists. We work from home, so it's not a big deal, but the whole scope of the business is different now. Like, you know, we, for a while, actually, when this shit started popping off in China, our packages were slow. Like, we were getting samples really, really late and stuff, and it was like, what's happening, really? Something's going on.
Yeah.
And then as this thing hit, like, they're kind of evening out, so they say, and things getting easier. We're getting a lot more packages, but now we're not there to receive them, right? Because the whole office is work from home.
That's what we're at.
So
right now.
Yep. I had it shipped to the production manager. He's got it. We gotta like do everything online, and it's just tough. You don't have access to all your files, all your things you need. And then, you know, it's like, who's thinking of buying clothes right now? So we're showing fall, right? We're supposed to be showing fall, and there's people out there like, you know, who cares? Like, where am I going to put in my stores? My stores aren't open anyway. So,
right.
Exactly. You know what I mean? So, yeah, it's affecting everything. Me personally, it's like, you know, of course, it's like, you're not going out. You're staying home. That's a little bummer. But
is it affecting your social life?
No, I mean, who cares? Like, that could be on hold.
Well, fortunately,
I don't have much of a social life anyway.
You know, I was actually thinking about that. Fortunately, at our age, you know, we're all mature people here, so we all have partners or we have spouses. So, you know, for the most part, we can keep in touch with friends, but we have our loved ones here. Like, we're pretty much set.
Exactly.
We're set. You know, I mean, if you're single right now, it might be tougher. You might be sitting in a room by yourself all day.
Yeah.
That I could imagine that being a little rough.
Yeah.
But I mean, you gotta make do with what you got. So like, I don't really, to me, I think like I should be saving money. Like, this should make me save money. But then again, it's like all the things you think of afterhand, like, oh shit, I need to get this, I need to get that, and it starts adding up. Mm-hmm. And as more and more things are closing, you have to get more and more like things. Like, I've been getting back in shape, I'm back in shape, but now all the gyms are closed, so I'm like, ah, fuck, I'm scrambling doing home workouts and shit.
Right.
But then
first world problems. Right there.
Exactly. No, I'm just saying,
yeah,
that's
no,
what
it's
at.
It's true. Yeah.
I'm scrambling because I want to stay on my routine. I've been on it for like, I don't know, 4 months now, and I'm pretty much set in it. I know what I'm doing, but now, so I just had to switch it up and do that. Thinking of buying an elliptical because I can't get an elliptical. You know what I mean? Like,
you are crazy.
It's like,
you are going about it the wrong way, my friend.
You know what I'm saying? But that's what I'm saying. Like, I'm thinking I gotta save money, but I'm like, shit, I want an elliptical.
They use like
dumb
a,
shit like that.
For weights, just like a gallon of water or something like that. I don't know.
A gallon of water.
I have weights. I have a couple of weights, but okay. You know, you want like to do cardio, but then you know they tell you go outside, and run around and shit. So I might go outside.
All right.
But I'm like too paranoid. Like it's that's how it's changed me. Like, I wash my hands all day long.
When you did it before? When you did it before?
I
mean, all right.
I used to wash it, but not like
Corona.
All
Thank
day
you,
long.
Thank you, Corona.
No, I'm talking about every
dirty
5 minutes I'm getting up and washing my hands. Every 5 minutes. Before, it was like you wash your hand before you did something. You go to eat or you go to the bathroom, you wash your hands. Now it's like every 5 minutes, I'm just washing my hands.
Yeah,
and I'm checking for fevers all day long.
But this is making me more paranoid of like the doorknobs, the handrails, the you know, anything in the street, even the doorknobs in my own building. Now I'm like, how do I know that people here are not
exactly?
Yeah.
What it does is it like it puts a magnifying glass on the little things you never thought of before. Like that you're touching all the time.
Yeah.
Like, never thought about it. Now you're like, you see it and it's like giant in your mind and shit. You're like, oh shit. The doorknob, the this, the elevator buttons you gotta press.
Yeah.
You know, like, wherever you go, there's things you gotta open doors in public, you gotta touch shit. The other day before this happened, you know, I went to get some like clothes and shit and I'm trying it on and I'm like, oh shit. Try on some clothes that somebody else tried on.
Exactly.
Before all this shit popped up, I'm like, but I never thought of it before until that. And it's like, you know, like in that scope, I never thought about it like,
right.
Oh, there could be something on this thing. But now it's like everything is highly, even in my own home, it's like the game. It's like, which came first? Did I come in here, walked in, with my jacket on and my pants, and I fucked up, contaminated the place. Now I gotta clean it. Now I gotta wash my hands after I clean it.
Burn my clothes every time I use it.
Oh my God.
It's crazy, man. We're living in like some weird times for real.
Definitely.
Let me ask you this. Do you think, and now you as a just so everybody doesn't think that you work at FedEx or something, all those packages you were talking about earlier, you know, you work at a clothing company, you have your own brand. Do you see the routine going back to normal, or are you going to be doing a lot of catch up and maybe changing the way you see things?
I hope it will go back to normal. Who knows, right? Who knows if this is like the new standard for it, because I don't think it's a week or two.
Right.
I think this thing is going to last for a long fucking time, and businesses are going to have to adapt to try to figure out how to maintain in this world, in the new world where you're not as interactive. Right now, what I'm doing is fall is already here, right? So one season, fall of 2020 is here. Their salespeople are showing it, right? I don't know if anybody's going to buy it because there's no stores or whatever, but that's one problem. So they're showing that this fall is there. The next season is holiday, and holiday, we designed it, it's done. It's coming in proto forms. So that's where the problem is. They're getting the protos and then commenting on it and then sending it, sending out comments and then getting the samples back. But right now it's just like research mode for spring and waiting for holiday stuff to come in. And that's getting sent not to the office. It's got to get sent to somebody else so we can go over it. But I don't think this is the type of thing that's even going to stop after like a few months. Dude was talking about like July, August. Mm-hmm. Like, that's your whole summer gone. Imagine you're quarantined for the whole summer. Like, why this shit don't happen when it was cold?
Right.
Freezing cold.
Well, I'm also thinking, how are consumers going to get back to normal? How are people going to be doing their spending, their shopping habits back to normal?
Mm-hmm.
How are employees going to get back to normal? Are we going to trust going back to the office? Are we going to trust our coworkers? You know what I mean?
I think some people would just seamlessly go back to that because they're just dirty motherfuckers anyway. You know?
They don't care.
You know what I mean? Like, real talk. Like, yeah. If those people out there, like, I see people outside doing dumb shit, like playing basketball and shit, like rubbing up against each other. Like, they just oblivious. So I think they can go back to it normally. Maybe it might change, like, on a level of science, it might change, like, every door opens by itself. You know what I'm saying? Like,
that's what I'm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, something might happen where you have less touching going on with interacting with things.
Yeah, I mean,
maybe it might change the way people greet each other. That'd be great if you fucking bow like the Japanese. I'm good with that. No more shaking hands or hugging and stuff. Like, who knows what would happen to all this?
I mean, the other thing that I'm thinking about, I'm hearing a lot of people talking about ordering food, getting it delivered at home. That's going to become probably more normal.
Yeah.
Because if you're kind of getting spoiled and doing it these weeks or whatever this is going to be. So all these new habits are going to create new ways of doing stuff. Like, hey, yeah, why didn't I do that before? Let's just do that from now on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I heard Amazon is like,
They're hiring more people
now because they're understaffed, because it's getting crazy out there in the deliveries and all that stuff. So
doesn't Amazon works with Whole Foods to deliver the groceries if you order?
Yeah, Whole Foods is Amazon. The guy Bezos owns Whole Foods.
Oh, I think that's why they're hiring more people, because people are ordering actually groceries so they don't have to go out.
Yeah.
And then be delivered to their homes.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, that's a thing that's been around. There's a company called Fresh Direct.
Yeah, yeah. No, I'm saying
they did that shit a long time ago.
These businesses are going to see a boom, and people are going to get used to it. Just like people started, it took a few things for people to get used to Uber, let's say.
Yeah.
And before you know it, now everybody wants to be on Uber because...
Yeah, that's the standard, yeah. But it's like, it depends on the industry, too. Like, they need to figure out a better way of doing things. They need to step their game up. I feel like for a long time, we've just been going along like status quo. I don't feel like there's been any big innovations or big changes in the world. Like, you know, there has been jumps that we've seen, right? We've seen like, oh wow, the internet, having nothing, no connectivity. Mm-hmm. Like you're just out here in the world. Somebody's looking for you. They can never find you unless you're home. And you're just free. Nobody knows where you are because you have no phone. And now we see a life where we can't live without a phone. But
exactly.
That happened. Nothing has come in that's like changed the whole, like shift the whole world and be like, oh, this is a move forward. So I feel like this might do it. It might help bring about something that changes how we do stuff.
I think and it'll definitely affect this new generation coming up, how they see things.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Sure.
They're going to be kind of raised up in this. You know, if you're going to school right now or going to college right now, you're going to always be having the back of your head, you know, working remotely, working from home.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Staying connected.
Or going to school from home.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Exactly. So that's going to change. Yeah, it's going to change everything. I heard that, you know, it sounds pretty hopeful that if you do catch it, that you can recover if you're in decent health.
Yeah. You can recover at home and you don't need to go to the hospital.
It's just, I imagine right now for me, like the biggest thing that got me paranoid was just, I just don't want the inconvenience of being down in the middle of this. Like, I don't want to be the sick guy in the middle of all this. I don't want to have to deal with doctors right now. I don't want to have to deal with finding a doctor or making a line for a doctor. I don't want to be out of work, like where I'm just like, I can't even function. At a time like this, I need to be functioning. So
yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's the thing that got me motivated to be like, yo, I really want to self-quarantine. I really want to make sure I stay healthy. I want to make sure that people around me are healthy and that we can all keep flowing. So, I mean, I'm glad.
So when was the last time you took the train?
2 days ago.
Like this week.
Yeah, I mean, this is quick. This is recent, but I'm not taking the train anymore. And you know what I heard? You want to talk about the trains. You know what I heard? I heard on the news, they were saying the MTA is losing money, and now the MTA wants a bailout from the government.
That's a business also.
Yeah, that's a business also. We forget that the MTA is a business, and they want a profit.
Yeah.
So now they're not doing shit for us, and they want to have a bailout.
And what they're doing is raising the prices every single year.
Exactly. What they should be doing is...
And they should have more than enough money. Like, you know how many people take this train?
If everybody stopped getting, like, if they took money out of the equation, it'll go easy. So whoever the MTA owes, if they're like, all right, during this time, you don't owe us any money. And then the MTA is like, all right, during this time, you guys don't have to ride the trail.
That'd
you
be
don't
awesome.
Owe us any money.
That'd be awesome.
You know what I mean? Across the board, if that happened, then everything would be like normal.
Damon,
like,
you're the man.
Get rid of money.
You're the man, yeah. Damon. Bring us to the
I'm
table.
I'm going to run for president.
Bring us all to the table so we could have a sit down and we can all come to agreements.
Yeah.
Nah, I don't want to go. I don't want to be in any room at a table with anybody.
I'm not shaking any hands. We can agree, but we don't have to shake hands on it.
Yeah. We're just like an air high five.
All right, D. Yo, thanks for calling in, man. Thanks for having a chat with us, and I hope you stay safe.
Appreciate you, brother. Y'all stay safe.
Yeah.
Stay safe out there in podcast world.
All right, man. We'll talk.
All right. Peace, y'all.
All right. And so now we got Dr. Greedy on the call here. Dr. Greedy, what's up?
In-house doctor.
Hello from Washington, D.C. Yep.
All right. You're the first person Carla thought about during this. When we were thinking of doing a call-in, a check-in on everybody for this quarantine, and we're like, we need a doctor. Carlos was like, I know the doctor. I know the doctor. Dr. Greedy's
got doctor.
The answers.
Yeah, doctor.
So Dr. Greedy, how has this been affecting you? You were telling me a little bit of how it was affecting your social life.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm a social type of guy. I'm single, you know. I'm out there looking for the love of my life, and, you know, I used to... You know, me roaming around in Washington, D.C. here, we have all these amazing restaurants and cocktail bars and just, you know, beautiful people from all over the world. Now I'm just like, I'm stuck at home alone, you know?
That sucks.
Oh, my God.
How did it affect the business? How did it affect your livelihood?
Well, I've still been kind of a little bit busy, like, before things kind of tapered off here, like, I was busy beginning of this week, and you know, I don't have a big office. I have like one room in like a secure office building, and they're still in there and everything. There's people still working in there.
Okay.
So I go in there, working one person at a time, and I clean everything up, and you know, so I keep it everything all kind of quarantined in there with my patients. And of course, if they don't feel good, they're not coming in. If I don't feel good, I'm not going in anymore. So I've been doing that, and I also work like energetically, like people at a distance. I do kind of like good and dead work, you know what I mean? So working people energetically from a distance and fix up their energy, tell them what to take. So I've been even doing that with people in Mexico right now and people sometimes in Europe, on the West Coast, everywhere, yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay. All right. So when if you do have somebody come in, well, first of all, what kind of doctor are you? Because we're here saying doctor, and people are not sure what that means.
It's complicated. So first of all, I'm a doctor of chiropractic. Okay. So what that means is I'm a doctor that focuses more on the function of the nervous system, but I'm still a doctor. So I still had to go to like regular medical school. I had to take all the prerequisites. I had to learn all the same basic sciences and diagnosis. And where we differ from medical doctor is where the medical doctor goes and starts learning drugs, I actually learn more about nutrition and anatomy and physiology. So actually we know more about that than the medical doctors do. Mm-hmm. And our clinic rounds a little bit different, meaning the medical doctors, they put them in hospitals, and most of us don't get put in hospitals. We get put into like little like natural health clinics. So on that front, we're a bit different because we don't experience a lot of the heavy duty stuff that they do.
Yeah.
But you know, some of us do. I mean, I went to school in downtown LA, people walking with gunshot wounds, like, no, we can't help you with this. We're going to call an ambulance for you. You know, like, people are like, no. I want natural. I said, you know, got to be like, not for gunshot wounds. No, not for gunshots. Yes.
It doesn't work for this.
So, I mean, are you at all concerned for your own safety, taking on patients that you don't know if they're okay? Like if they come in?
I'm not. I mean, so me, I have the chiropractic piece. I also have a degree in holistic medicine, which is a 3-year degree above a doctorate. And I have been studying lots of other stuff for the past 20 years. I have been, for the past few months already, I've been on all sorts of herbs and nutrition. I always keep myself really healthy and resilient. And I meditate every day. I work out. So the whole thing is with something like this, like a pathology, like a virus, a bacteria, whatever it is, mm-hmm. It could only take you over if you're weak,
right?
You know, gotcha. So there's an equation. It's called the germ theory, and the top part, the numerator, if you're looking at like math, the top part is going to be the virulence of the host, like how dangerous the virulence of the pathogen, like how dangerous is the pathogen. But the base, the bottom, the denominator is the resistance of the host. So mm-hmm. if the host has a lot of resistance, the pathogen can't do anything. Your immune system just wipes it out. Yeah, but you know, not everyone's like me. Not everyone's that healthy. You know what I mean? Yeah, that's the whole thing.
Are you taking any precautions as far as like wearing a mask when you're meeting people or gloves?
I'm not wearing a mask, but I wash my hands. You know, for the past 20 years, I've been washing my hands all the time. So I've been a doctor and I've had to work in clinics.
Four times.
And now I'm at home and I find, you know, I walk from the kitchen to the bathroom to the kitchen. I'm washing my hands each time. Like, I don't need to do that. It's just me here. Relax,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So I'm doing it even more. And to some people, that would be almost a little bit OCD, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, I totally had, I've always had I was explaining it to another person. I totally have a little bit of an OCD with washing my hands, keeping my hands dry, clean and dry. I just constantly have always had this. And if we're doing spray painting or something like that, you know, I'll hold it in. I'll kind of ignore it for the time being. But as soon as I'm done.
Yeah,
I'm like,
you won't wear gloves.
I don't wear gloves.
Wear gloves.
That's so
you're like,
weird.
No,
wear
gloves.
And, but then as soon as I'm done, you see me scraping my hands down. I'm like, I can't have this stuff on my hands. Now I'm like really extra paranoid. I'm like, I'm watching even the doorknobs and you know, in
it's good
in my building. I'm just so much more aware. How do you think this might affect your customers moving forward or your clientele moving forward? Do you see that people might come to you maybe after the fact to kind of seek maybe, you know, your wisdom? You know what I mean? Do you see that this might open people's minds up to other alternatives and ways of staying healthy?
The patients I have already they're pretty well educated. Like most of them, the ones that have been with me for a little while, they're not worried. It's like the super new ones, like they don't mm-hmm. get it yet because I always try to educate my patients. I think part of keeping people well is education. So go back to the Latin of doctor, docere, it means teacher. So mm-hmm. we're supposed to be teachers. Now, modern day doctors aren't really teachers. They just give you a pill or give you surgery and say, come, you know, that's
they,
it.
They don't even but give you the pill. They don't even give you the pill or the surgery. They just handle paperwork.
Yeah.
They just handle paperwork.
But, yeah. I mean, so I really try to embrace what doctor is, which means to teach people yeah. about, you know, how to take care of themselves and that they get in trouble. All right, here, let me fix that, you know? So I my patients have been coming in, they're pretty good with that. And I'm starting to do some videos now. I'm putting on my other Instagram, my doctor one, just to help people with meditation. I'm going to put more in there, help people how to take care of themselves, help people how to like meditate a little bit and calm down. Mm-hmm. Because a big thing about this is the fear. So when you're in fear, your immune system has a short spike and then it drops right off. And now what does the news do? It's getting everyone freaking scared. What is everyone else doing? Everyone's freaking out. People, I mean, I go on Facebook, people have like anxiety attacks on Facebook. I see like these people with like 20 posts and all these long, like winded. I'm like, I just gotta get off Facebook because it gives me fear, because fear is literally like a virus. It's contagious. You know, say, you know, back in our hunter-gatherer days, our tribal days, or even back, you know, toward the days of us just being like, bonobos, chimpanzees. Like, if someone was scared of something, it would have to go through the whole troop so we'd all be safe.
Right.
So fear, like the mind waves would just go to each other. We'd pick it up like instantly and we'd all be like, what's that? What's that? What's going on? But that happens with us even more with like the news and social media and going into the grocery store. So everyone's just like on that edge, but that depletes everyone's immune system. So if you're in that fear, your immune system is shot already. You can't combat anything heavy duty. And that's mostly why people get colds and flus all the time too. It's stress. It's just basic stress from work or home or school or whatever.
Yeah, no, I do notice that even in my regular routine, that if I'm grinding around the clock, if I have a lack of sleep, or if I'm just stressed out because there's some big deadline of some unreachable deadline creeping up, I'll see myself suddenly start sniffling more. I start like, you know, sneezing more, I start coughing more, like, I see it.
Yeah.
It's obvious. I'm sure a lot of people out there see that as well.
I think, in general, the whole world kind of, you know, with the exception of a couple of places here and there, the whole world kind of slacked on this, you know? They weren't ready for this. And we weren't ready for this, because this is a virus we've never been exposed to before as humans, so we don't have the immunity to handle it. That's the issue.
Exactly.
This isn't like an asteroid hit us. This isn't like a war, because as soon as it's over, we're going to go outside. Everything's still there.
Exactly.
Right, yeah.
You know, I mean, yeah, we have to get back to work. We have to, you know, get things moving again. We have to make money again, but everything's there. It's not like we have to rebuild our cities. It's not like, you know, we have to rebuild the whole society. Everything's in place. Yeah. And hopefully after this, we're going to make some major changes where things will be even better.
Mm-hmm. Right. Exactly.
The whole world, we just kind of had to push the little off switch and reboot and restart the computer. You know, that's what we're doing.
Yeah,
that's a good way to see it.
And even you can see it in the planet. Like, I've seen photos of Venice, and the water is looking clear, and dolphins are coming too. No, I swear. So maybe this is also kind of like a teaching moment for us as human. How are we living? What are we doing with the place we're living in?
And that if we could stop our footprint for just 1 second,
things can get better. Yeah.
Yeah, but and also, yeah, the pollution in the skies is clearing up, and all sorts of stuff is clearing up. Now the thing is too, the world has to do something about regulating whatever countries are messing with bioengineering.
Right.
Now, if this was done accidentally, well, yeah, that sucks. If it was done on purpose, well, even a bigger deal.
Of course, you know what I mean?
Right.
So you just don't know. I mean, because that's the whole thing. Like this, a virus, yeah, you can just like leave a door open or drop a bottle and boom, the whole world's infected. You're done. You know, that's the thing. This is worse than like, you know, than nuclear. This is...
Exactly.
It travels the whole world.
And it stays, I mean, because it's a virus, right? So who knows?
Yeah. You think you're going to be able to just get back to normal, or you think it's going to change the way you do things?
Well, I'm already changing the way I'm doing things because I've been lagging so much and, oh, I got to start putting videos online to teach people things. I got to start doing more online business. I got to get my website up. Yeah, so now I'm like, all right, now so I'm going to be sitting home doing this stuff with a glass of wine next to me. You know what I mean? So there I go.
So now you're drinking more. Gotcha. Okay.
No, I'm actually, believe me, I'm drinking a lot less.
Oh, good. Good.
Yeah, so... because, yeah, I was telling you guys like to go out and get my cocktails and socialize
and stuff like that.
So last night, I'm sitting here cooking in my crib and, you know, making all this good food and everything. and my whole idea was I'm going to sit down and have a nice glass of wine with this meal because I'm putting all this love into this meal and it's all organic good foods. And I wake up this morning and I realize I forgot to have my glass of wine for my dinner last night. Damn it. I forgot all about it. Yeah, it was going to be my treat.
Yeah. Actually,
yeah, but I guess
I actually resisted buying beer and I went with wine instead because I know that wine I'll drink it down like every once in a while I have a few glasses, but then I get bored quick just in case, you know what I mean?
You have a little taste and it's good, you know, and wine has a lot of good nutrients and antioxidants and other healthy things in it for you too, just as long as it's a good quality wine.
See, Carla, I'm being healthy. You see that? I'm being healthy.
That's nice.
Carla's been doing exercise now.
Yeah, I actually have to do it today. At least like 15 minutes, 30 minutes, because I don't do it regularly. So I'm trying to like, you know, build up kind of like a routine of doing everything.
Yeah. And I'm going to join in on that because I'm seeing that if my commute now is from the bedroom to the living room, then I'm going to have to do something to make up for that commute.
Yeah.
So, yeah. You see that meme of the guy in his bathroom holding onto the shower rod with his headphones on, like, I miss my commute to work.
Yeah.
But exercise is great because not only is it healthy for the body, but it also stimulates your neurotransmitters to make you just mentally feel better. You don't get as depressed, you feel happier. It keeps your immune system up too. So exercise is important. And they shut down my gym on Sunday. So I was like doing a lot of heavy weightlifting and stuff like that and everything. And I always was saying, well, I want to get back into running and yoga. And like, well, now I have to run and do yoga. Here I go. That's so I'm going to switch it up. I'm going to slim down a little bit here, you know, so
yeah.
In a good way.
Greedy. So last thing, how do you think this is affecting graffiti?
Well, it depends who you talk to, you know.
Has anybody heard from Scene, from the old timers? Like, are they safe? I want to make sure they're safe, first of all. First and foremost, they should stay
hopefully
away from people.
They're staying home.
I don't think Scene even leaves his studio, man.
So
he just sits there. He just paints canvases every day. That's all he does.
I don't think it would affect graph. It's the social gatherings. That's about it. The big events, like the graffiti.
Yeah. Thing.
That's about it.
Yeah.
But I think a lot of the people on the DL are just like planning their hits on the, you know, the layups and the highways and rooftops and all that stuff. No, they are.
Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah. Yeah. That's now true. now that things are emptied out. Yeah.
Yeah.
And security's lower. Yeah. I could see that.
But if you see Greed anywhere like that, it wasn't me. All right. Just let you know. I have a medical license to maintain.
What he was just saying right now was an admission, is what he said.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, no, some people are planning some things. I'm just saying, hypothetically.
I don't know. I've heard it somewhere.
All right, Dr. Greedy, thanks for the check-in. I hope you're staying safe. Thanks for the info. Actually, you know, it was really calming to hear some of these things that you said. You actually just, I might have to send me the bill for this. I think you actually helped us out here. Because this is good information. It's good to hear somebody sounding.
This is what people need to know, like.
Yeah, to hear a calm voice, a rational voice, explaining some things, and.
People are gonna die. People are gonna die this year, no matter what, right? But yeah, some more people are gonna die this year. It's inevitable. It's what's gonna happen. But for the most part, most of the people really don't have to worry, and you know. We're going to have to sit there and help the people who did have some tragedies and some people passed away. But for the most of us, it's a reset. We're going to get back out again soon. Life is going to be better than ever.
All right, Dr. Greedy. So let's talk soon. Let's be in touch.
You too. Have a good one. Have fun. Good luck exercising and enjoy some wine after.
All right,
thank
man.
Thank you.
We'll talk.
Bye-bye.
Peace. All right, so on the phone call now, we got Cousin Terry, Twrexx, DJ Twrexx.
That's right.
What up?
What up, man?
Hola, primo. I'm calling you from sunny South Florida, the Fort Lauderdale area.
All right.
Yay.
How's everything with you down there, man? Let me know. How has this all affected you?
Actually, I'm going to be unemployed just because of the coronavirus. So that's one thing that I'm kind of worried about. I was working for a company in China, so everything that I do consists of China. The only thing is that in order for me to do the work, the contract that I had was I had to commit to a certain amount of days a year in China to work with the factories and work at the offices over there. Starting since December, I was supposed to be back in December, didn't go. It wasn't for the virus. It was kind of like scheduling issues, and then I was supposed to go for February or March. But that's when it all started going down. Like my own boss, he's actually Canadian, and he was in Bali, and then he ended up going back to Canada with his family. So this past Monday in the morning, I thought everything was fine because even though, you know, shit is going down, like my my boss was telling me, like, yeah, we just got to get the next line done. You know, where it is, that he's showing that we're still working, we're still getting done no matter what. You know, and I'm like, all right, cool. You know, I'm not stressing anything, not worried about it. Even though in the back of my mind, it's just like, that check going to come in? Because, you know, I'm not going to China. I'm not committing to those days.
Yeah.
But let alone, soon enough on Monday, I got a message from the company itself just letting me know that my contract, when it's up in April 30th, that they're just not going to renew it. And I mean, I understand it. I'm not really mad at them. They were very happy with me and the stuff that I was able to bring. But even though it's starting to get better in China and they're still under quarantine, who knows when the States is going to be
right.
good to go. Right. We hear from the news, we hear from 3 months to up to 8 months, up to a year. So their concern is just like, well, we're not exactly sure when you're going to come back to China.
Right. So why keep that contract going? Right. No, absolutely.
Yeah. So the way that company works is they usually have what they call a order fair. So when they build the line, they got the order print. They just got like, I don't know, about 500 to 1,000 people coming in from all over China from the stores to come and see the product. And then they order what they want for their product. Mm. Obviously, that has to be canceled because there's no sales.
Yeah.
The footwear is not necessarily, you know, it's an apparel company. So the footwear wasn't necessarily like their main thing, but it was what's getting profit, a lot of profit in the beginning from my boss working there. He's actually my friend, so he was the one that kind of like found me. So they've given him the okay to be able to hire somebody, another foreigner,
right?
And that's how he reached out to me,
right?
And you know, long story short, you know, I went for the interview. They like what I was able to offer. I think it helped since Champion is very popular, and a lot of the footwear stuff that's Champion is the stuff that I did design. So that kind of like captured their in China. Champion is huge, so that captured their eye.
Yeah, they're hitting it big right now. They're having a big resurgence.
Not only with the regular original stuff, but the bootleg champion scene out there is crazy, bro.
Killing it.
It's bonkers, bro. I've taken pictures of like just like the wrong logos or saying Sharpie they spell it wrong. But people rocking that shit. People really rocking that shit. I had a guy in China reach out to me because he knew that I do the Champion stuff to see if I can design Champion bootleg for him.
Okay.
And I was just like, nah, slow down. I mean, at this point, now that I'm going to be unemployed, I'm going to reach out to him like, yo, so what was that that you want?
You want them champions? I got them champions.
Yo, I got you, man. Yo.
Champignones? I got it, man.
Champignones, yeah. Campeones.
Oh, my God.
But, yeah, man, so, you know, I mean, it is what it is. Look, you know, I know we spoke about it, but we're talking on the podcast, so just explain to the people, like, I myself feel a little lucky that I'm not really a big spender. You know, a lot of us in the industry, as far as design, we do get paid fairly well. So I'm pretty good about saving money. Not necessarily the amount that I would like to have to feel safe to be unemployed per se.
Nobody has the amount.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I really hope things look out well. One of the hardships that I'm feeling right now is that Florida itself, in general, is not really. I mean, well, it depends what type of design you're into. Mm-hmm. There is a lot of graphic design and apparel, but as far as the footwear industry, there's really no jobs in Florida. For right. the most part, some of the minor, there's the one company that I worked for and other footwear designers that I do know that are in Florida are mostly like just freelance based people.
Right.
So yeah, that's the tough. I'm obviously like, what do you call it? Living in certain places, you're kind of limited to things. You know, it's not like, for example, like if you're a mechanic or if you're a doctor, an accountant, man, you can move anywhere. Every city needs those kind of people.
Well,
design jobs.
You're my cousin. I've known you for years. You were working for a bunch of years for a company remotely. I mean, to me, that was stunning. You were doing it before this quarantine. You were already self quarantined for years.
Oh yeah, no. As far as being isolated at home, I'm not worried about it. I mean, I'm actually right now in the backyard just to like not bother my girls working right now, but. Yeah, no, I'm kind of used to it, like being at home, but it is a little crazy just because you're kind of being forced to be home versus like, hey, I'm working from home. Let me go take a walk and grab a coffee like when I lived in Brooklyn, you know?
I hear you. I mean, but the thing that I'm thinking is what I'm getting at is I might be optimistic, but I'm predicting that more companies are going to be comfortable with the work at home scenario and they might look for people outside of their own area. They might just, they might look for the most qualified person, even if the person isn't able to come to the office. You know,
look,
I'm feeling your vibe right now. Is you're glad that you put money away. You're glad that you thought ahead, even when you didn't, in case of a situation like this. and that you're just worried about your next move. You're worried. You're being cautious about your next move.
Yeah.
Adulting, bro. Just remember that word, man. Adulting. So, because I remember when I was in the Boston office and my coworker, like, we'll always hang out and talk, and he's like, he would always tell me, like, straight up, like, how the fuck are you always, like, broke? How do you not have money? And it's funny now because, like, my girlfriend makes fun of me because I still write checks. Yes, I'm 46 and I'm old school. but I also, like, even though everything's online, like, backing is online, I still literally have my checkbook where I literally write every single thing down that I use, that I pull out of my debit card. Because, one, my paranoia. Two, to know exactly where my money is. And three, to make sure that, because I've had issues where the numbers are different. So to make sure that whatever the numbers on the list are the same as the numbers are online, because then, okay, where's so-and-so money? What happened? What happened now?
Yeah.
Only once I noticed that there was like an Uber. I had to change my card because only once I thought there was like an Uber charge somewhere. I don't know where. I don't even remember where. And I was like, ugh. But that was me just being like stupid, like anal about like checking online. And like, oh man, got to make sure my money's there, man. We got to make sure my money's there.
Oh man. So, yeah, how are things down in your area though? As far as like, have you gone shopping? Have you been able to stock up? Have you guys? Why are the stores and how are the streets?
My girl did go out a couple of times, and she told me there was just like some places were just ridiculous. Like Target, they had like a line like through the aisles. Wow. And then she went again. I think the other day or that same day, like later on at night, and she took pictures. She sent to me like the aisles were just completely empty, empty. I made friends with one of the guys that have a brewery down here.
Okay.
So I'm painting a mural with him. And he's feeling the pain because he's a small business owner. I think they're being mandated to close, but I don't know if they're forced just yet. They're at least selling bottles of beer that they'll, you know, you just got to drive up to the door and they'll take it out for you. And they have food there. They're offering like free hot dogs for kids.
Well,
for
that's
kids,
good.
For kids. And, yo, it is what it is, man. I spoke to my brother the other day. Like, they finally closed the restaurant down, and he's worried. That, you know, if anything, because I've been reading a lot about this too, the main people that I worry to about the most is the service people.
Yeah.
Think about it.
Yeah.
You know, all these people are like, you know, not only do they not get paid that well, a lot of them live paycheck to paycheck. A lot of them depend on tips.
Yeah.
They get paid below. The restaurant industry pays waiters below minimum wage because they figured that they balance it out with tips at the end of the night.
Yeah.
So now with no work, you know, it's easy to say if you got a laptop and you're a designer, like, oh yeah, you know, I could work from home, no problem, I can wherever I am, but these are service people. So my brother's feeling the pain too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's for that. And then my mom's got me all nervous because her boss tells her that she still has to go to work. I'm like, yo, why the fuck are you going to work?
Yo, for real, man. That's nice. Just not right.
It's ridiculous. Yeah, that's a paralegal company. Like, I don't know why. I'm like, mom, you can easily take it. Like, my girl, she has a laptop, but she brought her monitor home and everything. She was literally knowing that it could be up to 2 weeks that they're not going to work.
Mm-hmm.
My mom can easily, like, try to take the computer to the house and work, you know, it's a paralegal company.
Yeah.
Not like they're really, like, letting people in anyway. But she was telling me, so I was like, so what's the deal? Like, you're surrounded by people. You work with clients. Like, oh, no, but they let the clients, you know, we're talking to the clients by the phones. We're not letting them in. I'm like, all right, well, I mean, I guess that's good. But still, like,
yeah,
she's got me paranoid because she's in that age. And on top of that, she's out and about. I'm just like, yo, mom, like, don't hug anybody. Don't get close to anybody. Yeah. If you need to get a fight, like, be smart about it, you know?
I mean, the fortunate thing on life down in Fort Lauderdale is that you guys travel by your own car.
My car, yeah.
So you don't have to expose yourself in the subways to a million people every day.
Oh, no, yeah. I've been seeing that in New York, too, man. New York as well.
Now, here we got that issue. That one issue here is transportation.
So is it true, like, again, I to be honest, like, I never know what's true or not nowadays in the media, but is it true that the government is suspending, like, the rent, mortgages, and all that shit?
I heard that
was
about
a petition.
Well, that I heard about it in France.
In France, but here is a petition that it's going around so that people sign to see if the government.
Oh, so it's not fine. Because I know Cuomo, right?
Cuomo.
Yeah.
I feel like Americans got comfortable in that sense.
Yeah.
You know, obviously, so a lot of us, like, my paranoia just puts me in my mind. It's like, it's sad to say we live in a capitalist, you know, country, so money is power. So that's why I was just like very hardcore about putting money in the bank and making sure I don't spend money on shit. But
you know what though, T, you and I, Gen Xers, We're survivors, uh-huh. man. We were ready for the apocalypse.
Oh, my God.
We grew up on Mad Max. Sure. We grew up on Mad Max.
I've seen that too. It's like, oh, so all you millennials that just can't stay in the house.
Yeah.
You know? We're used to staying at home and, you know, grunge and, you know, emo. Nirvana till the day I die, bro.
Listen, man, as long as we have gasoline, we're all right.
I got it. Chris, I got it. Smashing Pumpkins.
Smashing Pumpkins.
Oh, my God.
Man. R.I.P. R.I.P. Mao. R.I.P.
Yeah. Now, let's make it clear. Not Smashing Pumpkins. Smashing Pumpkins.
That's what my cousin used to say. Smashing Pumpkins. Mao it. Oh, man. Yo, listen. So, T-Rex, man. First, oh, well, before we let you go, just, yo, thank you so much for the remix, man.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
I appreciate it, man.
Yo,
to be honest, thank you for getting me back to just making music between you and my boss, actually, because he started making music. But somehow it has become a little bit of therapy lately. So I appreciate that you guys gave me that cappella to begin with, you know?
Hey, listen, that's dope. And I guess this is kind of good timing in that way, right? We got to find the blessings in the curse. And this is the blessing right here that you're getting back into creativity with your music.
I had this conversation with an old lady, like, I don't know, maybe a month ago. Like, I also DJ, in case nobody knows. So I did a set at this car show with one of my friends, and this lady and her husband came up to us, and the sweetest old couple. Like, they were talking about that they had a record vinyl, that they used to have a record shop, and they used to actually press the vinyl back in the days, and, you know, the most awesomest conversation. And then the lady just decided to be like, hey, do you have kids? And I'm like, no, I don't have kids. So long story short, the nice, sweet conversation we have, I had to bite my tongue before I told this lady off, because she was like, well, what's going to be your legacy? I'm like, well, legacy is not necessarily represented by a kid. To my point, like, look at artists and look at people like legends, people that are considered legends. Like, not everybody that has been a legend or had a legacy has had kids.
Yeah.
Like, what are you talking about? And yo, she just started calling me selfish. You're just selfish. Like, trying to brush me off.
I thought she was gonna hit you with the atheist. What is this, an atheist?
Yo, she was. And look, even we got into a little bit of politics, but yo, I don't insult nobody. Like, and the conversation was perfectly fine. Like, even with a little bit of disagreement, because she did say something about the Chinese people, and I'm like, look, I work for China. I don't want to hear that. That's very offensive.
I don't even want to get into that. Yo, but,
very respectful, bro. Like, I was just trying to bite my tongue and not be the asshole, because, you know, two wrongs never make a right. You know what I mean? Right. Oye, pero siguió with the fucking, you're just selfish. And I'm trying to explain to her, like, well, why would you think it's selfish? Like, I'm trying to explain to her why the reason that I don't think it's selfish. And to top it off, I feel it's more selfless that I'm not having kids. This is what I didn't tell her, because I got so pissed and it was only after that fact. But I'm like, I think selfish is the people who actually try to have kids for the excuse of their own happiness, and then those fucking kids grow up to have to, like, struggle in life because you weren't ready to be a parent.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
No, you have a valid point, and I've heard that point. I have two sons, but I have also heard that point, and it's completely valid. I totally understand that.
I am 46 years old. I am a Latino American, and I grew up in Miami, not in the best of neighborhoods, and I've seen it. 15, 16-year-olds having kids. I've seen a little bit older, the you know, Latino families. Oh, why are you not married? You guys should get married and have kids.
Exactly.
Make me a grand. So I've seen it. I've seen the people that are forced to all of a sudden have kids. And next thing you know, it's like, that lady wasn't necessarily a good person to be a parent to begin with.
Right.
So, mm-hmm. When you said, my point to add, like, we just talked about, like, therapy as an art. It's like, yo, at the end of the day, like, the day I go, like, the only thing that I got to leave in this earth, at least, I believe it's just whatever I created in life.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not as far as, like, I really wish I had more patience to paint the way you do, but, like, the little bit of art that I've done, the music that I've done, the murals that I've painted, I hope that's going to be what's legacy. It's like, hey, you know what? And to top it off, my character towards other people.
Yeah.
I've said it before many times, bro. Like, I am definitely more a believer just being more selfless and caring about your community and people around you. Just being selfish. Bro, what has selfish brought to anybody?
That's true, man.
Great.
I like these words. I like these words from T-Rex, man. T-Rex, you've been meditating. This quarantine is working for you, man.
I'm gonna create my own religion, bro. Because make up my own.
You gotta start writing a book.
Exactly.
That's what you should do.
You should start doing that now that you're quarantined. Notes from T-Rex.
But yeah, man, I wish I could write more, man. I definitely have a lot of things done. That I've been through.
Just write, man. Just make a little pet project. Just put that on the side and just write notes. It might help. Maybe it might help to clear your clear some of your thoughts, you know, and get your next stage focus, your next chapter focus.
But we'll see where it goes, man. At one point, when I was living in New York back in the days, like, I started to try to, like, write a journal.
Yeah.
I don't know why, man. I don't know why I have, like, this, like, I don't know, insecurity or timid thing about, like, my stories, I guess, but even the journal itself, I was embarrassed to reread it, and I stopped. Mm. It's weird.
That happens.
Yeah. It's just, you know.
Give your pages a shout out. Let us know where they can find your music.
So my music, not that much music now, but I'm hoping to do more than what I've done. soundcloud.com/Twrexx29.
Okay, cool.
Instagram is Twrexx Monsta. Monsta, M-O-N-S-T-A. And there you can see what I do pretty much on a day life, like from shoes to murals and a little bit of art here and there.
And you just put up some new music. So we said you did the remix for Carla for Edis too, and then you also have a new track. What's the name of the new track?
The new track is Static State. And just to know, as far as like we were talking about earlier about like therapy, like Static State was basically more just like what's going on. I feel like the song, like, I captured, I was about to put like the parts of the JFK presidency, you know, kind of like make it a little political, but I decided not to. But I think the mood itself, like the static state, like we're just in a state of just like, don't know what to believe, don't know what to do.
It actually works.
I think it fits fairly well, and that's why I could have worked on it more, you know. But I feel like that's what I felt deep inside, and I feel like I just needed to like release it, and I know, kind of like I started like as far as like new production for me, because honestly, like, I haven't done anything since 2013, since I moved to Florida.
Yeah, so listen, maybe we'll have you on another time once you get a couple of more tracks going, and we can talk about your process and how do you go about putting stuff together, and we can have a whole conversation just about that.
Awesome, man. I appreciate that. Hopefully when all this shit is over, we don't have to talk about this bullshit.
Yeah. Cool.
All right, man. So, I'm going to let you go, man. We got to get back to our stuff as well.
Yeah.
But
no doubt, man.
Yeah, but it's been great talking to you, man. All right?
Oh, no doubt. Likewise, man. You'll be safe out there.
All right, so now we got on the phone, straight live and direct from one of the five boroughs in the city, Mr.Arc.
Hello.
What's good, Mr.Arc?
Not much.
Quarantine?
I've been just quarantining, yeah.
How's the quarantine going?
Yeah.
It's long, it's boring.
What?
It's been getting to me already, but I've been trying to keep busy.
It's been 2 days, 3 days.
I know.
Do some exercise, so like, some
it's
yoga.
It's felt like forever.
Mr.Arc is a high school student in the city. He's been quarantined now since Monday. The school's closed. But you were just telling me right now you weren't on a meeting?
Yeah, I was in a meeting because I'm part of a advertising agency. That runs after school.
Okay.
We take in real clients from, I guess, nonprofit organizations and private businesses, and we try to help them advertise their companies more. So if they need a logo design, or if they need a remodeling of a website, or if they need advertisements to just kind of promote themselves.
Right.
We'll help them design that and help them put it together.
That's cool.
So because, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, because of the quarantine. So how do you guys have a meeting if you guys are all quarantined?
So he emailed all of, my teacher, he emailed all of us to tell us that the schools are shut down, but they're willing to keep open our agency, because we have clients that need this stuff done, and we can't really like sit around and not do it, because then nothing's gonna get done.
Right.
So he emailed all of us and told us to install this app called Google Meets, which is kind of like it's kind of like FaceTiming, but everybody at once.
Yep.
So it can handle more than, I don't know, five people.
Yeah.
It can handle up to maybe 30, or, you know, I don't know how many, because there's only about 20 of us.
Right. Yeah.
So we all got in. It's kind of overwhelming because everyone's talking at once, but
bunch of stupid kids.
But you know, you get used to it, and it was a little awkward at first, but you know, after like maybe 30 minutes of being in the call, we all got used to it and started, you know, collaborating almost like we were all there in person.
Good. All right. Yeah. Did it feel weird for you to be like in your home, in your room doing this?
Yeah, it felt kind of weird to kind of have my room almost like a classroom setting.
Yeah.
That's what it felt like. Like bringing my own private life into school.
To know
that like this is how my other classes are going to be as well for the next, I don't know, 2-3 weeks. It's, I don't know, gonna have to get used to it.
Yeah.
So to tell me a little bit about your experience with this whole thing. I mean, they just shut down the schools on Monday. How were the students and the teachers and everything up to this point?
The students, we've all been trying to keep on top of it, like trying to understand what we need to do in order to keep moving, and also in order to prepare for what is going to be the next couple of weeks, because we have no idea. Once they shut down the schools, all they told us was that we're going to report back to school April 20th, but we are still kind of like oblivious as to what is happening right now. The teachers, on the other hand, they're still reporting to school.
Oh, really?
I didn't know that. They're having meetings right now to try to figure out how they're going to digitize everything and turn it into remote learning, which is what they call it. There was one class I know that already had kind of a lesson, but it was more of an introduction lesson, kind of like how my meeting was.
Yeah.
But they were they sent out like our curriculums and everything, what we're going to be trying to achieve. They've set up these things called Google Classrooms, which are almost like a stream of work that they assign, and you can get it offline, you can make copies or whatever. But everyone's kind of panicking right now. Everyone's trying to figure stuff out. And the students, we're all just like really bored at home right now. Like nothing is really assigned to us yet.
Right.
So we're all just kind of having like a pretty long break, but since we're all quarantined, like there's nowhere to go, nothing to do. We're all kind of stuck in our houses.
Man, thank God for video games, right?
No, I actually haven't even been able to play much because I have to do this animation advertisement for, the Department of Education is doing this thing over the summer called free summer meals, where they allow anyone to go to schools around the area and get free meals, free food, whatever, over the summer.
Right.
So I have to do an animation project that'll be displayed on all the Link NYC terminals around the city, which are these, they're kind of like these machines that have like a monitor on it. It has like a bunch of advertisements of what's going on in the city, and you can also charge your phones there and get whatever help you need.
Let me ask you this. You think it's difficult to focus at home?
Yeah, it's different for everyone. For me, not so much. I mean, I have other people in the house, but it's not like distracting. Like I don't feel like distracted by the other people around me or the other things around me, like TV and games. Like I'm not distracted by it.
Right.
Once in a while, yeah, sure, maybe I'll watch a movie or pick up a game and, you know, do other things aside from work. But I think like
a balance of everything. Watch out, your teachers are listening.
I think a balance of everything has kind of helped me. Like I've been trying to do things, you know, with the rest of my family. Like the bond is there, like everyone's kind of bonding.
Good.
Which is good, because like everyone's kind of in a state of panic, and you know, we all need kind of to get each other through this.
Yeah Well said, man. Who is this kid, man? So you traveled, you were in Italy when this happened. And you came back from Italy and managed to come back
right
before they started shutting down Italy.
Yeah.
you were really lucky that you didn't get caught up in that, and you're lucky that you're not sick right now. Did you get a little scared?
Yeah. I kind of got scared coming back, because after I heard about it, like, I thought it was only an Italy problem, but like, then I was, when I came back, I kind of thought, oh, what is everyone else going to think? Because we just made it out and this is already blowing up on the news.
Yeah.
Like, what are people going to think about us and, you know, everyone who went on the trip? And of course, you know, it ended up being an issue. Like, a lot of kids were thinking that Corona came with us, and I have a teacher that he's been getting emails from parents saying, oh, my kid says that, you know, you guys went to Italy and,
oh my God,
and there's the coronavirus. And the worst part is my teacher was Asian, so everyone was saying he had Corona.
God.
It became a big deal. Yeah, it became a really big deal. And, you know, and then once we started figuring out that the coronavirus was already spreading to so many other places, and once it got to New York, forget about it, everyone was panicking. I was a little scared because it was spreading really fast and everyone in my school was beginning to get sick.
Right.
It was starting to get to the point where it was already like normal to be sick. Right. For like about a week, everyone was sick. Teachers were calling out, students were absent, the attendance rate went down drastically.
I mean, but that probably could have just been a regular.
Yeah.
Obviously, it was just a regular like cold or flu thing or whatever.
Yeah.
Not the coronavirus.
Of course. So that's the other thing, though. Like, no one really knew, because, like, the school wasn't doing proper checkups, I guess. Like, they weren't really looking for it. They were just asking simple questions, like if students had a cough. But the worst part is students can always deny that they have a cough if they don't want to admit to being sick, or they want to stay in school with their friends. And also, you know, symptoms aren't super obvious of the coronavirus. Like, some people said they didn't have any symptoms, or if they had symptoms, they were super close to having the flu or a regular cold.
Right.
So it was kind of unpredictable.
Yeah.
That's the scary part. Yeah.
The best place you could be right now is at least, you know, staying home and then at least watching for the information to start building up, because eventually they're going to start to know more accurate information.
Yeah.
And then it'll be safer for everybody. I don't know if you noticed in the news, but they were talking about how millennials are the ones to blame for this, that they're spreading it more. Now they're
spreading. Maybe because they're symptomatic and they're just going out and don't.
Well, they're saying
worrying about it.
Yeah, they're saying that their age is that they're in a social age right now.
Yeah.
So they feel invincible. They feel like they can't.
Yeah.
Die from it. So who cares?
It's just that thinking of, if I'm gonna die, I'm gonna die anyways.
Yeah. The president was talking earlier today, and in the news, one of the doctors or whatever that was there with the president, she started mentioning that. I was like, really? We're going to blame it on the millennials now? Now the millennials are the ones to blame.
Yeah, it's crazy.
I mean, I kind of understand, like, that the whole, like, that they're not understanding kind of thing. Like, they're not understanding the real danger of it, because, yes, it might not affect, you know, my generation, for example, as much, because maybe our immune systems are built to be stronger. But if we carry it to, you know, a place where maybe there's a lot of elderly people or little babies, like, that's where the real danger is.
Yeah.
When you can spread it, you know, towards other groups of people.
That's why when you came to visit, I kept you at an arm's distance at all time and in a bubble.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Plastic bagged your head.
Oh my God, yeah.
That was tough, right? It was hard to breathe in there, right?
Yeah.
I'll teach you to go to Italy.
Oh my God.
All right. All right, Mr. Arc. So tell me, what are your top 5 tips for surviving the quarantine? What are you doing?
Well, me right now, I'm trying to keep as busy as possible. I'm not really trying to stay lazy. Like, if I stay lazy, I know it's going to feel even longer, and I'm not really going to, you know, keep track of time, and then, you know, I'm going to lose a lot of time. So one thing I'm doing is just trying to stay by my daily routine, which is, you know, checking up on my emails, making sure that, you know, my teachers are contacting me, and trying to join all these classes, set everything up so that next week I can start learning smoothly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right now there's not really anything that, you know, right now they're not giving anything, but they're still asking us to, you know, set up all our stuff, because as soon as next week hits, we're going to get loaded with work that they're going to be posting and all that.
Of course. Next week, they're gonna assume that you're all fully functional next week.
Yeah, we're going to get bombarded with work. So, yeah, right now I'm just trying to make sure I'm on top of that, eating at the right times, making sure I get to sleep at the right times, because even though it's, at school, I still need to stay on schedule. Exactly. So that if for whatever reason we go back to school, I'm still on top of things and can keep a keep my mind on top of things and go to sleep and function at the right times.
That's a really good point. I'm glad you're saying that, and you're very self-aware. I'm so proud of you right now, son. Oh my God, I'm tearing up. No, that's a big thing from working from home, all the years of my experience working from home over the years. One of the hardest things to do for any human to do, and it doesn't mean that you're a bad person if you can't do it, but it's definitely something that you have to conquer for yourself, setting your own schedule. It's very easy to have a schedule and be a morning person when somebody forces you to get up because you have to be somewhere. But when you don't have to be anywhere, you're literally working in your own space, it's very difficult not to end up staying up all night or, you know, falling asleep in the middle of the afternoon. So yeah, if you find yourself doing that, find ways of keeping yourself entertained and keeping yourself on track. That's a good point.
Yeah. And it's gonna be a lot harder now, because now it's really on us to get to like our classes on time.
Yeah.
Because now it's all digital.
Exactly.
So they're gonna expect us to get on these calls at the right time.
Exactly.
And they're gonna expect us to get all this work submitted at the right time.
Exactly. So it's all on you.
Schedules are super important.
This is great training for the future of this country. I'm so proud of you. Give a round of applause for the future of this country. all right. No, that's really good. Another thing, you know what, I'll wrap this up with, try to eat healthy and stay healthy, and exercise is another thing, because that's another element that we forget, because we're not moving around as much. All of a sudden, it's gonna hit you in a couple of days. Like, your metabolism's gonna start to come down a little bit. Well, you're young, you'll be fine, but you're gonna start to slow down a little bit, and you need to find ways to raise your heart rate and to keep your energy up. And exercise is one of the biggest things.
Yeah, like, I'm already seeing it, because, you know, for my birthday, I just got this Apple Watch thing, and it has, like, a fitness kind of activity ring.
Okay.
And it's already telling me, like, every day, it's like, Aiden, your ring isn't full, like, because usually, you know, with my commute, you know, I fill up this ring.
Oh.
Every time I get home, it's usually filled up, because I'm walking up steps all day. I'm working out, I'm doing all these things, but now that I'm not going to school, and now that my commute is kind of, it's gone, you know, my rings aren't filled, so, you know, that's definitely something I have to get back into, working out a little bit at home.
Keep that in mind, whatever it might be, whether it's push-ups, jumping jacks, or just running around the block, or just going to the backyard and kick the soccer ball around, do whatever you got to do, just to stay active, because that happens, you can get a little claustrophobic like that. And you're probably gonna, your brothers and your sisters and your family are gonna drive you crazy after a week. So it's a good excuse to keep yourself busy and doing things.
Yeah.
All right, Mr. Arc, thank you so much for your wisdom. Oh my God, I didn't expect this wisdom coming from such a young guest, man. Jesus Christ, you always raise the bar here.
Yeah.
Incredible. Yep.
All right, Mr. Arc, thank you.
All right, thank you so much. All right.
Yo. What's the deal, Holmes?
What's good, man?
What's up, Carlo?
How are
you? Wait. Hold on. Am I live?
Yeah, you're live.
Chill. You got to tell me that first.
Audible Lecter's in the house.
I'm changing my voice and shit over here. Yeah, okay. What's up, dog?
Guillotine cuts.
What's good, kids? What's the word, yo? Staying safe?
Staying safe, staying inside the homes.
Staying creative.
Yeah, making, man.
Yeah.
Making art and making music.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, well, we gotta first of all, I gotta work from home, so that's that. And then and then all of a sudden we have to be healthy, so we gotta start exercising and doing kinds of stuff because we're not doing anything now. We're not moving around, right? So
now all of a sudden, yeah.
Now we're
yeah.
like just we just have to do exercises. We're doing YouTube videos and
oh shit,
yeah,
running up and down the stairs.
Yo, we just got yeah. to, man. It's legit. If we don't start now, it's gonna catch up on us and it's gonna be harder.
Yeah,
it's crazy, and no more gyms right now. So. Exactly. If you don't got that Peloton in your room.
Right. Yeah. Our gym was walking to a train.
At least, yeah, at least every day I'd be walking around now.
Yeah.
Now there's no reason to walk around, so I'm like, damn.
You take that for granted, man. You go walking to the train, there's a freaking, there's like a infestation in there, bro.
Yeah. Oh, dude, I'm so paranoid in the train, man. These past week that I had to still go in. Yeah, I kept like trying to dodge out people, and you just can't. And then of course, like you sit down, and then like some odd character sits in front of you with like wet pants, like for no reason. His pants yeah, are wet, and he's got a whole bunch of bags. And you're like, and he's not. You're not sure if he's homeless or what, or if he's just a little crazy. You don't know what's going on, but you're like, but why do you have to sit in front of me, dude? Like I'm right here. I was good, and you're all wet.
Bro, yeah.
you're expelling stuff. Why? No.
Yeah, I'm a germaphobe like freaking years before this, and so imagine this, Leo.
Oh my god.
Now this is like extreme shit.
Now you're OD germaphobe, huh?
Yeah, no, yo, and the thing is, you go to the fucking supermarket, and then you notice that like you're the only one wearing no fucking mask.
Yeah.
It's just crazy.
It's true. We went to a supermarket, and on the walking to the supermarket, there was a lot of people with masks and like gloves and all that.
Yo, I walked outside today, and this dude straight up screaming, like running up to people, just screaming at everybody.
Oh my
that
God.
Shit looked like the first sign of like those crazy, like, the real zombie apocalypse. I was like, oh shit. Yeah, this guy was just like, this is some shit you see in the movie. He was just like, ah! And then go to the next person. Like, ah! I was like, what the fuck?
Oh my god, the other day there was someone, like a crazy guy near the train station, and he was screaming. Yeah. He was kind of like, Corona, Corona is gonna get you.
Oh,
Corona. Yeah, I was like, what the hell is wrong with you?
You don't do that, man. You don't do that. So, what
the hell is that? Yeah.
So, just to let our listeners know, so this is Mr. Audible Lecter. He used to be one of the three from the Cortesnyc NYC live stream.
Yeah.
The old school.
OG in the house.
Classics.
And Audible Lecter is one half of the duo Guillotine Cuts with Spax the Apparition. Shout out to Spax. And they are music producers from New York, from Queens, New York. Hip hop beats, all kinds of remixes. Hopefully they'll be blessing us with one. Maybe. Maybe. Now
during this quarantine, right?
During this quarantine. Maybe they could bless us with a little remix or something, man. They got time now. There's no excuses now. Now you guys got don't tell me, oh man, your work is killing me, man. Yo, okay.
You know what's crazy? I've had to work from home for the past like 10 years.
Oh wow.
So like I'm used to this shit.
Right.
But now I used to at least have the kids.
He's handing out. He's handing out welcome badges. Like here's your name tag. Welcome to my party. Make yourself comfortable.
Nah, but you know, now with the fucking kids at home, this shit just flipped my whole life upside down, bro. Like you really ain't getting shit done in the house now. It's really fucking crazy.
That's true.
It's just crazy. You know,
how's
I'm
the
like,
fam? The fam is good or what?
Fam is good so far, so good, everybody, you know.
Good.
But it's just crazy. It's like you got to test yourself like every day. If you really could test yourself, then
right.
Those people that are, you know, in that have been exposed or have to fucking go out, like the wife, she's forced to go to work. She
really?
Don't, it's crazy. Yeah, she's on call tomorrow. I'm like, what the fuck?
That's crazy.
But, you know,
what kind of business?
They work in a bank, so. You know, people want their money.
That's
why I was telling people, I'm like, yo, go make sure you have enough to hold you down for a little bit, because like, she works in a bank. There's people there fucking withdrawing 40 G's, walking up in there, 10 G's, 50 G's. I'm not kidding.
What do they know that we don't know? Are they running out of the country or something?
No, but the thing is, if by any reason, what if the banks, something happened to the bank and then they take your money?
I'm using my credit card.
No, but the problem is that we have money saved in the bank, bank account.
Well, it'll be insured, but like, God knows what'll happen. Like, yeah. I mean,
that's true.
Supposedly, but you know, when the first thing that happens, when chaos starts coming about, people run for water, you know, all the necessary
toilet paper.
Exactly.
Water, and for some reason, toilet paper, and
toilet paper, and the fucking, and you want to try to have cash, suppose, you know, if it's gonna do you any good at the end of the world and shit,
right?
Get a lot of toilet paper, I'm gonna shit myself.
Yo,
I'm scared shitless.
I'll say, yo, you decreasing your amount of squares you use?
Man, I'm trying to save. Trying to ration.
Yeah, so I've decreased 10%.
Yeah. Oh, that's good. That's good, man. That's good. You're not doing the full pull down roll out, right? You're not doing the full swoosh roll.
No, man. Yo, no, you gotta fucking, like, you stop short now. Like, ooh, oh, that's for next time.
I hope you're washing your hands.
I wash my hands
all good, as long as you're not reusing. Just don't reuse. Don't come with that story.
Oh my God.
Don't tell me you're reusing, man.
Bro, no. Chill. You know what's gonna get to? It's gonna get to fucking.
Yeah, I'm saving that one for later. I'm saving that one for later right there. Don't touch that one. That one's fine. I'm saving it for later.
Ew.
Start washing pañales and shit.
Oh my God.
So nasty.
Disgusting.
Cool. Okay, what about the food? Let me ask you this, because you got a family, you got a full house there. I think you're probably the first of the conversations that we had that has a full house.
Yeah.
But you're the head of the household. No offense to Sarah. But so how was it stocking? Like, did you have an idea, a plan when you said, yo, I gotta stock up for the house? Like, did you say,
bro,
what was your plan? Yeah.
No, because you know, this was actually a couple of weeks ago. I sent you guys a picture when I went to Costco, and the entire water was gone. Like, that whole section was gone. And I was like, what the fuck? But they still had everything. This was like a while ago. So I was like, that's when I started freaking out, because, you know, the water is the first shit to go.
Mm-hmm.
So we were like, yo, I asked the people, the staff, and they were like, nope, sorry, nope, nope. So then we went to Food Bazaar and bought like 3 cases. Thank God they had that. You know, Junction wasn't on. They weren't thinking about that shit yet.
Wow.
But that was a week. That was weeks ago. So I feel like I still gotta get shit. Every time I go, everything's gone.
Did you have like a priorities list? Like,
I bought
meats, first vegetables. Like, what was your thinking? Because that was hard for me.
Hell yeah. I bought mad like chicken breasts, mad like, you know, chicken with the bone to make soup. I bought a whole bunch of like cans, those chicken breasts in the cans, which is nasty, but just in case.
Yeah.
Fucking hot dogs, everything I could freeze, bro. I mean, and you don't ever know. If electricity's gone, then your meat's gone.
Exactly.
So,
I had some of that thinking too,
Beans, I don't even like beans, but I buy beans and fucking Chef Boyardee, whatever the hell you can, you know.
Yeah.
Iced tea and like.
Yeah, no, I think my thinking was first off, get
alcohol.
We're going to get to that subject in a second. We'll get to that subject in a second, because that's a good combo with you. But first my thinking was obviously milk and all the stuff that we always buy, because now we just got to buy a little extra. Yeah. But you don't want to buy too much fresh stuff, because you don't want it to rot.
Yeah.
So you have to have a reality check between how much can you consume and how much can you stock. Carla was making fresh juices. She just started making immediately. She started liquefying vegetables and all that, making a lot of juices.
So she
started doing that. So I would go back to the supermarket and buy more vegetables, bring back more to kind of keep stocking up. And then when we kind of reached a certain point, I was like, all right, we're good.
Yeah.
Then The next thing was meats, but the meats were gone at the time that I went. Yeah. So there was no what? Meats. Yeah, there was no meats I in the went, supermarket.
Hell yeah, no, anywhere, bro.
Yeah, I went on...
Cold cuts, too.
Yeah, I went on Friday, and there was still some. So I got some. And then when Chris went back on Sunday, there was nothing, which was crazy. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then we went to another supermarket, and we found, like, some things. But that supermarket is Asian. It's, like, Korean. So I think people are scared of going there.
So, well, that's why I got lucky. And I, because the one that I have around me, the two Asian ones.
Uh-huh.
But that's the thing. You go in there and you're like, every single person has a mask. And I started freaking out. That's when I was like, oh, shit.
Absolutely.
Yo.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, I mean, it's a little paranoia, but at the same time, why not be concerned, right? Why not be a little cautious?
It's fucked up, yeah. But it's not their fault.
So right. So I quickly went through and started getting like what you just talked about. Hot, like instead of hot dogs, I got like sausages, like different chorizos and things like that. I was like, yo, if worse comes to worse, dice up some chorizos with some like something, make a little soup or something, cut up some potatoes, like
hell
make
yeah.
up something that kind of gets you by. And the chorizos, you know, whatever. So I was like, all right, chorizos will do for meat for now until I can go to the supermarket again. Canned foods, I got a bunch of canned food stuff that I normally...
Soups
and stuff.
Because
those are like lunches and snack stuff that like...
You know, noodles and pasta, yeah. like potatoes yeah. and shit like that. Rice. Got a
yeah.
big
yeah,
bag
I got
rice.
A lot of that because I figured that will like fill you up. So even
yeah,
if you
exactly.
don't have anything else, you can eat that and... Feel like,
I got bread. I froze. I got like 3 packs of bread frozen.
Oh, now we know. Now we know what house to break into. We run out
yeah, yeah, bro. You know, I have to. Like I said, those. I got the entire like the chicken breast with the bones. So you make a whole soup from that, and that shit was like $2. I was like, oh,
yeah.
Got lucky before they started killing the prices.
Exactly.
So then after all that, when we got back home and we were like good for like 2 days. And then we realized, yeah. like, yo, we took a real look, and I was like, oh, snap, light bulbs. I got no light bulbs. I was like, oh, shit, I don't got extra light bulbs. And I was like, oh, snap, you know what? Toilet paper. I know it's a joke. I know everybody's laughing about it, but I really didn't prepare.
Yeah, we just, like, got what we will get regularly. And
yeah, so I was like, maybe we should go back and try to find some more. So we did go back a second day. And that's when we got we found that they did restock the meat. We got the extra toilet paper, we got the extra light bulbs, we got some extra vegetables, fruits and all that kind of stuff. Then we got more cereals and things like that.
Cereal, yeah.
Now our kitchen looks crazy. It had never
been. Yo, our kitchen looks like Abuelita came over. We had Abuelita come over and hooked it up.
seven pantries. Yo, I got like 8 packs of eggs, bro.
Oh my
but I
god!
I went through one entire pack today alone.
I mean, yeah, because
you got a family.
Like two for each.
It's
yeah.
crazy.
How many heads in your house? What's a head count?
4 plus Fax.
Yeah.
Is working from home too, so he's next door.
Yeah. So.
So
I
we
mean,
be like, you know.
Of course.
Yeah. No. Cause things go by fast, bro.
They do.
Yeah.
Like
do.
A lot, you know. That's why I was trying to get pasta and like. Potatoes and just everything you can.
Yeah.
But who knows? I mean, this is all right, supposed to go on for a while.
So let's talk the real deal. Let's talk the real thing that we got to talk. How do you survive? How does a drinker survive this apocalypse?
Yo.
What'd you do?
Well, I had to... What I did, I had to tell myself I'm not going to drink.
What? I did the same thing. Let's see how long that lasts.
I did the same thing, but then the first day, it didn't work.
Oh, my God.
I'm just kidding. So I was like, you know, I'm going to ration this. Just, you know, I've got the huge-ass bottle of some nice, good whiskey. But then I was like, okay, it's only going to be like this much. Every time, but that shit doesn't work.
Oh man,
it's a temptation. Temptation.
We went to the liquor store. I was like, Carla, let's walk to the liquor store. She's looking at me like, why are we walking to the liquor store? We thought we were gonna go to the supermarket to get supplies. I'm like, well, we gotta stop at the liquor store.
That's first.
And well, I mean, I did it because it was the heaviest. So I was like, all right, let's go to the liquor store. We went to the liquor store, and I was like thinking really careful. Like, should I get beer? Should I get wine? Should I, you know, liquor? Like, and I was like, you know what? If I get wine, like, I don't mind drinking wine, but like, I get bored of it real quick. Like, I can have like a session of where I'll just drink a bottle maybe in a night if we're just having casual drinking, and then I won't drink wine again for like a week because I'll be like, I'm bored.
Yeah, no, that's me right there. Yeah,
I get bored of it real fast. I'm like, yeah, it wasn't that fun. So I'm like, all right, I don't want to drink that again for a while. So I got a bunch of bottles of wine, and I got some whiskey. I got two different whiskeys. And then I purposely didn't do the beer because I said, yo, if I get beer...
You're going to be drinking all day?
I'm going to be drinking all day. I know that in the middle afternoon, I'll be like, oh, I have one beer. Then by the evening, I'll be like, I have another one. And I'll be like, ah, that's another beer. And then next thing you know, I go through a whole six pack and I'll be like, oh, man. And then I'll be
like... And then it's like... It's 10 p.m. and Chris and he's playing beer pong in the living room.
Yeah, I mean, like, what the hell is going on here?
I know. That's the problem with beer. Beer is so recreational and it tastes good. So it's like it's hard to be like, oh, I'll just have one or two.
Yeah.
And the problem with beer, the problem with beer also that I was thinking of is that it takes up room in the fridge.
Yeah.
So that's another reason why I was like, if I get the bottles of wine, I could just store them away. I probably won't even realize I have them. A week later, I'll be like, oh, shit, we have wine. Let's have a little party. We'll have a little bit of wine, and then we'll save the rest for the next, probably the next 2 weeks. We'll be like, hey, let's have a little more wine. Yeah, man, that was hard. So let me ask you this question. What about the other supplies?
Oh, that's supplied, bro. I can't.
I have to give in something. I'm not going to give everything.
But the funny thing is, I've had so many calls that I'm like, I don't know, man. You know what I'm saying? I don't know.
People trying to get
like
it from
people
you?
People already asking. I'm like, I don't know.
Oh, my God.
I don't know if I could... I don't know if I could
get... No, I had to supply oversupply.
What?
Imagine if it goes for months. Like, the way it's looking, I don't know, man.
Oh,
it's not
man.
Cool. And they close bars. Now the the liquor stores are probably the next shit to go. Like, imagine.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's like I feel like I supplied for like maybe 2 days.
Okay.
No, just kidding. Like, I'm talking about the liquor, you know.
Yeah.
But you gotta buy. You know what you gotta do is just buy those fucking box wines and cheap ass nasty shits. And just add water and like take like a little sip.
Oh my god! No.
You gotta be like fucking using that shit like it's like gold.
Drink water.
But all right. So you guys are managing. You guys are surviving. Let me ask you this: how did it affect your work, man? Your business?
Well, I'm messed up, but
Wow.
I didn't have a full time. No, I had projects. Everything got fucking put to the side. Wow. Ain't nobody trying to do shit. You know, I was even supposed to do some DJing that was coming up in April. That shit got put to the side now. You know, because they were all happy they were going to open the rooftops and shit.
Right.
That got put to the side, and God knows how long it'll take, man.
Wow.
But as far as other people, thank God, you know, well, the wifey work in the bank.
Yeah.
So should have a steady paycheck for as long as we know. But some of my boys, you know, the people that work in like hotels and shit like that, it's really bad, man.
Yeah, man. People are getting laid off. People.
I already have
a couple of friends that got laid off.
I have a friend.
Not even starting yet.
She works in a hotel in Baltimore, and first, they told her that she was going to be kind of like terminated for temporary laid off. That's what they told her. Until May. And then they told her that the hotel closed. So now the hotel closed and that's it. And I think they're working until Friday. And
shit.
That's that. That's crazy.
Yeah, because think about it. They have how many cruise ships just hanging out in the water right now, trying to get to like somewhere, and it's like nobody's flying. Everything's getting shut down. Nobody needs a hotel.
Yeah,
cruises are fucked. Airplanes are fucked. It's so bad.
Yeah, in her case, her hotel is more like for business, so there's nobody traveling for business right now.
Oh hell yeah, that's the first to go too.
So they have nobody staying. They have no events, so they had to close. It's crazy though because that's a big chain hotel. Which I'm sure they should have some amount of money, like the corporation itself, but
yeah, no. Marriott is, they shut down, they basically cut off 50% of their employees almost.
That's crazy.
The Hilton's doing the same. It's crazy. Like, oh, JetBlue, like all the airlines are like, whew.
Yeah.
Just ridiculously bad right now.
Yeah.
Yo, and so, I know we've been chatting at the group chat, the friends group chat, and you've been talking about this. We've been monitoring the stocks going down.
Oh, plummeting, bro. Down. They should have closed that shit a while ago. But they, you know, they're trying to give everybody hope. So it's like crazy. No, like companies that were like, let's say hundreds of dollars, like Boeing was like $400-something. That shit's like $80 right now.
Holy crap.
I mean, they had problems before because there was like three flights, like different places that, you know, it was the same plane that got fucked up and right. You know, they had to take it out of commission. But it's crazy, like almost everything, bro.
Yeah.
Are
like 401ks are hurt.
I don't even want to look at it. I don't think I've even gotten it in the mail, a statement, in a long time. They're probably afraid to.
Yeah.
Yo, man.
It's going to be bad for a while, really. I mean, it sucks. But supposedly they're going to send money to your crib and shit. You know?
Supposedly,
you know?
We're going to see if
that. Trump himself is going to show up to your house and give you
Hold on. Hold you downstairs. My bad. Let me go get my money.
A full-size Trump Trump like poster or something.
He's
gonna
text
show up.
You. He's gonna text you. I'm here.
Calm down.
Come down, bitch.
It's DoorDash. No,
here's
no
your
contact.
1,
yo, pull up. I got. I'm in an Uber. I'm in the black Uber. Just pull up.
Yeah. Oh my god.
Open the door. It's in the lobby. Yeah. I can't go in, but it's in the lobby.
It's just a bunch of dollars. It's like a bag of dollars. There you go.
Oh, man. That's crazy, man. All jokes aside, yo, I really hope everybody stays safe and shit.
Yo, what do you think? Do you think they should shut down the city or what?
They should a long time ago, bro. We're mad behind, yo.
So you're all...
Like, we're really fucked.
I wonder,
we were supposed to be like Korea, but we're like Italy right now. And they said that our numbers are like way above what they were at this point in time when they were going through shit.
Yeah. You know what they're gonna do in the reporting to spin it and make it sound like it's not that bad? They're not gonna talk about the amount of people, they're gonna talk about percentages.
Of course, yeah, percent.
They're gonna be like, we're not that bad. Look, it's only 40% got.
And their thing is, because we're getting more tests, and people are getting tested more, that's why our number is going high.
Yeah.
But
the best president in the world was like, let's not do tests because I don't want the numbers to go up.
Yeah.
qué ridículo, de verdad. Qué ridículo.
Yo, man, I would have been so upset if I was those people stuck on that boat. That he didn't want to let that boat go back to the United States, come to land. Y'all would have been so crazy, man.
Hell yeah. Are you kidding me? That shit's crazy.
I wonder if they have legal...
If we leave them there, the numbers will go down.
Yeah, it's incredible. Oh, my God. Él es loco. Un loco.
Yeah, man. Yo, listen, so thanks for the phone call, man. I'm glad that you guys are all right. We're over here staying safe.
Yeah.
Give our best to Spax. Tell him to face. Stay safe and show his face every once in a while, man.
Yeah, for sure,
man. He really is the apparition. He's always like ghost.
Yo, word. I sent you an album that was funny. I just came across the other day, and I was like, damn, this is crazy timing. So I remember playing it on the live stream. It was called The Culture of Fear.
Yeah,
album.
I was playing a little bit of it. Yeah.
They got some, you know, like, you know, everything is a conspiracy, but you got some shit, like, there's a good timing for it.
Yeah.
All right, man. Yo, so stay safe. We'll be talking, and all right. Be cool.
Take care.
Yo, hashtag Bill Gates did this. Just kidding.
All right, man. We'll talk.
Bye,
careful. Peace.